spirit. It is the vital element that governs everything. Everything is created, sustained and dissolved by and in Dharma. So Dharma is common and universal. We cannot say that India only has Dharma and all the other people, they have no Dharma at all. But the difference, the speciality of the salient features of the Dharma of this Bharatavarsha or Bharatadesha is different from Dharma of the other civilizations. The instinctive ethics, the instinctive morality is governed in all human beings or in all creatures in their respective ambience and gravity. But there are two things we want to say. We know the types of respiration. For example, if you take the fish out of water, it will die. If you put some mammal or reptile which cannot get that atmosphere, this hydrospheric oxygen, which cannot get that oxygen, if you put them into water, they will die. If you take out of water, it will die. If you put, that will die. Because each and everybody, they respire the oxygen from the hydrospheric and atmospheric backgrounds. Likewise, no doubt everybody, they have dharma for their existence, but that type of dharma in subtlety, in primordial nature is more because it is the birthplace of Dharma. This is the place where Dharma, number one, Chaitanya, consciousness, number three, divinity, number four, Acharya, that is the lineage. All these things are conglomerated, contemplated only in this area. That is the salient feature for land. We have Acharya Parampara, that is the spiritual lineage, the scriptural lineage, that is the Shastra Parampara. Their understanding of divinity and manifestations is rightly taught about the consciousness which is present in all elements, insentient and sentient. So these salient features, they distinguish. For example, if anybody does dharma or not, that is entirely different. That is a supportive faculty. But far as the basic dharma is our life itself. Vidusho atikrame danda bhuyastvam. Persons who are there in dharma, those who have entered into the values of ethical nature and morale, by the gradual upgradation of the civilization, that is utterly different from people, those who are rooted, roasted, toasted in dharmic principles. And if we are aberrant from the orbit of dharma, if we are derooted from the axis of perfection and precision of our traditional values, the impact will be heavy than any person doing the same. Because we are having a dharmic base and our aberration will have a deeper impact. The impact will be very colossal. And the practical implementation of dharma, the benefit will also be more to us. And also if a person is aberrant, the ill effect will be more. It makes us to have the carrier of, to be the conveyor of global consciousness, global harmony, global civilization and global leadership as a consequence. That is the greatness of us. Likewise, I want to say three differences from making the historical pride to be implemented in these present situations. First thing is the persons available. Second thing is the position, the ecosphere or the atmosphere, whatever you say, social, economical, political, other things. And three thing is the people, the mentality, mental setup and receptivity. So the first thing is, when the historical periods, that is the periods of Vaivasvata, Manuatri, Samvarta, Katyayana, Brihaspati, Parasara, Vyasa, Shankha, Ligita, Daksha, Gautama, Shatatapa, Pulastya, Karma, these people, they existed. And the aspiration and inspiration given by these personalities which radiated the Varahamihira, Chanakya and various other people, they are known as Shastrajnas. So those people, the scholarly people, the scientific community, the sages and seers, we have lot of people with various levels of spiritual gravity. So the persons who existed for promulgation of this pride to be translated into potential action and impact, such a type of people accept their treatises, accept their messages available in transliteration and translation, such type of people, they don't exist now. Number two, the atmosphere in which they nourished, the atmosphere in which they have been irrigated, the people have been irrigated and fostered with the knowledge, the same type of conduciveness that does not exist now. And persons, the receptacles, that is the shrotas or the svikartas, those people, they were totally getting into the field of surrender. The field of surrender, the field of service and field of sacrifice. These three things are essential for getting into scriptural and spiritual receptivity. So service for others and sacrifice at the case of any distress and despair, as well as total surrender to the eternity, divinity and truth. So these type of things don't exist. So this India Century Mission, I've already told, it may appear to be a myth or miracle or a chauvinistic approach for each and every Indian, each and every person. Like we have French pride, we have the German pride, we know about the British colonial pride. It means they always, they wanted to rule the world. What was the pride of Alexander? So it is not a pride, without any rational background or with a sense of just colonization or permeation or imperialism. It is not India century in that manner. It is to take the maternal care of the globe. It is to take the paternal care and concern for the knowledge development of the course. It is to take the preceptorial guidance for the world. So yesterday I told in a lecture that we say that we are great not because of our arrogance or self-appraisal. We claim that we are great because we want everybody to be great, and our greatness lies in making others great. So it is not just arrogance or self-appraisal. So likewise, we have to create India Century Mission. It is a mega project and master plan, and no doubt we know that now we are having more members. The Christian community now, which is ruling nearly one third of the global population, it was started, implanted only in 12 hearts. There are only 12 disciples of Jesus. And the way in which they followed, it has been implanted in such a manner that it had uninterrupted lineage, follow-up, commitment in spreading the message with an institutionalization, a project of institutionalization. It is conceptualized, visualized and institutionalized. So that has made one third of the population. We have more numbers than what we had. But we may have to create the impact. Mere quantitative comparison, it will not come for the rescue. So that is the greatness of our country, that all the others, for them, the dharma may be food or water. For us, the vital breath itself is dharma. We have sukshma dharma, we have parama dharma, we have adhyatmika dharma. So our dharma is utterly different. It does not only comprise the thing with physical, cultural, psychic and intellectual moorings, but also understanding of the self, understanding of the ultimate reality and understanding of the process of emancipation. So it deals with eschatology, metaphysics, cosmology, ontology, on various other sciences which are impalpable to modern science and technology. So that is the greatness of us. So we have started a process of India Century Mission. So as the time is very limited, I have to just quote what are the properties of India Century Mission as well as the projects. Number one, I have already told that it is to be institutionalized. We have to take care of stabilization of our own nature. There are two types of India Century Mission message. One is the message of India. Message of India. It is given to the people or subjects of India. It is for stabilization. Second is the message from India for the global community, that is for dissemination. So unless we stabilize ourselves, we cannot just go for dissemination of knowledge to other people. We do have the evil heads of poverty, malnutrition, infant mortality, female infanticide is also there. Then employment, education, lot of problems are there. So unless we stabilize ourselves, unless we make it as a movement, which must have a broader, wider and deeper network, we cannot get into dissemination at all. Number one, it starts with education. Forgetting about the other community, the budding community at a time of impressionable age, they must be instilled in the value-based education. Value is of three types. One is the career value. Second is the character value. And third is the course value. They have to understand what they study. That is the course. They have to understand what they are going to do in the course. That is career. How they are going to behave with the core denizens of this global community, that is known as the character. To behave within yourself, with your domestic, social, national and global spheres, how you are going to act and activate, that is there. So we have to start a value-based education, that is ethically based education, that is a religious-based education. Everybody thinks religious as a biased product. If you teach religion, it will create some sort of disparity and cleavage in the minds. It is not though. If it is untied, I have already told, if religion is not taught at all, if the knowledge of our heritage is not taught, you are in a dark room. If it is mispreached with chauvinism, extremism and fundamentalism, then you are in the same dark room with a black tiger. So these things are very dangerous. So it does not mean that secularism or something does not mean that you must not teach religion. Teaching religion in the real sense in which it preaches sympathy and empathy, altruism and cosmopolitanism, that is the greatness of real teaching. So number one, education. Number two, microfinancing and employment resources. We have to deal with employment resources. How to make employment resources. Number three, pooling up the resources of our nation. Most of the people contributing to foreign countries, no doubt they are earning much, but the contribution, for example, somebody told that a lot of our Indians are there at NASA and various other international institutions. So it is good for inspiration. It is not for productivity. We have to retain the resources and youth potential by providing more opportunities. It is possible only by a public-private participation, a participation of a potential masculine government with a group of vibrant citizens and subjects of the nation. So employment is second. It is also very essential. Third is rural empowerment.